And this session will be chaired by Peter Wright. Peter.
Thanks, Samrat. So the speaker, first speaker in the session is Rohit Pappu from Washington University in St. Louis, and he'll talk to us about phase behavior of linear multivalent proteins.
Thank you, Samrat, for putting this meeting together. It's fun to be here. So what I'm going to do today is tell you about the phase behavior of linear multivalent proteins, a topic that has sort of been alluded to in something that Richard talked about with respect to NPM1. And he showed a variant of this slide in his talk, where he sort of gave a vignette of various membraneless granules. These are sort of membraneless bodies, and as Richard pointed out, they're quite prevalent in RNA processing. And these liquid-like bodies are thought to encompass multiple proteins in RNA. But from a physics perspective, the question I'd like to set out to ask is, what sort of liquids are these, right? I mean, are we talking about simple liquids? Are we talking about something that's like water? Are we talking about something that's quite different? So right off the bat, I'll tell you that these are quite different. They're polymeric liquids. They're formed by cooperative interactions amongst what we'll refer to as associative polymers. And depicted here to be stickers interspersed by spacers. And the nature of these stickers and the spacers is what we'll focus on today. So these stickers interspersed by spacers have the characteristic of being connected by physical crosslinks. These are going to be non-covalent interactions that are readily reversible. They will have characteristic time scales. But the key issue is that we'll form a network of these interactions, and we mustn't lose sight of this because the underlying liquid actually has a structure defined by this network. So the terms we're going to use are things like associative polymers, stickers connected by spacers, and of course networks. So I'll sort of introduce you to a few archetypes of these stickers and spacers from nature. There are the proteins that Mike Rosen popularized, which are basically going to be folded domains connected by disordered linkers. Here is a synthetic example of something that Mike studied, which are multiple SH3 domains connected by linkers that bind to ligands that are also multivalent in that they have multiple proline-rich modules connected by linkers. Now, when you think about these types of associative polymers and physical crosslinks, the first thing that comes to mind is the fact that these physical crosslinks can sort of cross a threshold network, which we refer to as a percolation threshold, whereby most of the molecules become part of a system-spanning network, which we refer to as a gel. And the concentration, the bulk concentration above which that gel point is crossed, is, or that percolation threshold is crossed, is called a gel point in terms of the concentration. Now, of course, the curious observation is that these multivalent proteins don't just form system-spanning networks. They're readily identifiable by the fact that they make these spherical droplets. The sphere essentially highlights the fact that there's a finite surface tension. They fuse, they drip, and they, if you frap them, they sort of recover quite rapidly. So the obvious question that arises is, where is the network, right? When you think about a gel, you're thinking about physically cross-linked entities. And it turns out that phase separation, which is what Richard referred to, which gives rise to this droplet, is not a network transition in and of itself. It's a change in density whereby the molecules basically huddle into a droplet, giving rise to two concentrations. One for the dispersed phase we'll refer to as the saturation concentration of the low variety, and then a droplet phase where you have a saturation concentration that's high, and it coexists such that you end up with this particular observation, which is that the concentration in the dispersed phase is quite a bit lower than the concentration inside of the droplet. We still haven't talked about a gel here. Now, in the case where the gel point happens to live between these two concentration limits, we can essentially end up with a phenomenon where phase separation drives the formation of a droplet-spanning gel, because you essentially get the gelation for free, right? Because the gel point threshold is crossed inside of the droplet, because the concentration of proteins inside of the droplet is actually quite a bit larger than the gel point. So you end up with a physically networked set of proteins inside of the droplet, which basically is an important observation, because what it says is that you confine the gelation to a spherical architecture. You can, of course, have the gel point be smaller than the saturation concentration for phase separation, in which case you get gelation without phase separation. Now, the key point is that valency alone does not tell you whether you get one or the other type of phase transition. Valency simply says that you get physically cross-linked networks. So what we discovered recently is that it's actually the disordered linkers in these multivalent proteins that determine whether gelation is driven by phase separation or if it occurs without phase separation. So what is the key linker property? We'll sort of distill it down to one integral. It turns out that you can write out the sequence and then from it calculate something we refer to as an effective solvation volume. But basically what it defines is the average volume that's set aside per residue for interactions with the surrounding solvent. So you could sort of imagine that a chain likes itself, its excluded volume, and therefore effective solvation volume is negative. It doesn't care, in which case it'll be zero. And it's really determined by the effective pairwise interactions within the residue. A movie helps. So here are two WW domains in each case connected by a linker. Here's a very compact linker, has a negative effective solvation volume. Here's a linker that's completely agnostic about whether it interacts with the solvent or with itself. And in this case, you have a massively expanded linker. It turns out that these values for the effective solvation volume that are either zero or positive actually make up predominantly what the disordered linkers look like. So what we set out to ask was, how does the effective solvation volume of disordered linkers influence the phase behavior of linear multivalent proteins? This is work that Tyler Harmon, when he was a graduate student in the lab, did. And this was motivated by several conversations with Mike. So we want to do a calculation. This has to be tractable, so we do this on a lattice. So I'll show you sort of two limiting types of data. So here, each lattice is occupied by a spherical protein that happens to represent a folded domain, an SH3 or a PRM. They're interspersed or connected by linkers that either occupy specific points on the lattice, which will be the so-called explicit linker model, or they're just phantoms, because in this case, the effective solvation volume will be zero. What I will show you is that from a purely valence-based theory, both of these systems should show equivalent phase transitions, but they don't, as you can see here. The linkers with a zero effective solvation volume readily form spherical droplets. The entire network is confined to that droplet, whereas the linkers with large effective solvation volumes actually make box-spanning networks, because essentially what's going on here is the linkers push their elbows out. They want to resist confinement, and so what you end up doing is crossing a very high concentration as a gel point before which you'll form a percolated network. Now, what you can do is, you can actually sort of quantify the full phase diagram whereby you actually see when you get one or the other transition, right? And so this is what a true phase diagram would look like. So on this axis would be the concentration of the proteins that you care about. Here, let's say I was going to tune the affinity between the SH3 and the PRM. There will be low affinities where essentially you end up with a continuous transition from a sol to a gel without forming a droplet. But conversely, for higher affinities, what you will see is a coexistence of a dispersed phase with a droplet phase with a gel point plumb in the middle, suggesting that what you'll end up doing is form a gel or a network inside of the droplet, right? So there isn't a either or thing going on here. What you instead have is a convolution of the two phenomena. Now, what's really beautiful about this is that the width of this two-phase regime that defines the convolution of phase separation and gelation is actually tunable by sort of modulating the effective solvation volume. And here, what I'll do is show you what happens as we titrate this property of the linker. What you will essentially see is that as I increase the effective solvation volume, the width of the two-phase regime will basically, sorry, that went by fast, will essentially shrink. So what you'll start to get is a gelation without phase separation. So if I play it backwards, you essentially see the widening of the two-phase regime. Conversely, when I increase the girth of the linker, if you will, what you will end up doing is basically getting salt to gel without much of a phase separation. So this becomes a tunable commodity, meaning that essentially, now the properties of disordered linkers together with the valence of interaction domains or motifs determine the phase behavior. It's not an either or situation. And for linkers, the key parameter is actually this effective solvation volume, which is really nice because it's encoded directly by the amino acid sequence. And we are at this juncture where we can actually calculate this parameter directly from sequence by way of simulations. Gelation driven by phase separation will actually seem to promote phase transitions at physiologically relevant concentrations because you need roughly 2 to 3 orders of magnitude smaller amounts of protein to drive phase separation or phase gelation this way. And the key point is that because the effective solvation volume is tunable, you can sort of imagine that post-translational modifications like phosphorylation and the like will actually tune the effective solvation volume. So that's sort of part one. And it looks like I'll only get through two parts, but I told Peter among friends I can steal some time. So the second type of systems one thinks about, of course, are stickers connected by these linkers, but where the stickers are not so obvious. And if you've been paying attention to the field, there has been this sort of lurking controversy, right? How do you get stereospecificity in terms of high valency interactions when you don't have folded domains? We're all trained to thinking that you need specific folded domains to give you specific interactions. And so the question becomes, if I give you a protein that has no obviously folded domains in it, and I yet observe phase separation, what is the multivalency of? And that's the question of, you know, identify stickers. So here are examples of FUS, DDX4, LAF1, all of which come under the category of being fully disordered proteins where everybody routinely invokes multivalency. So the question is, what are the stickers in IDPs? Julie Foreman Kay has made several suggestions, which we'll see are actually right. And Hugh-san, who is here in the audience, will probably tell you about a theory later in the conference that he's developed. We've gone in a slightly different route. So what I'm about to tell you is a collaboration between our lab and the labs of Simon Alberti and Tony Hyman at the Max Planck, and involves the following individuals from our respective labs. And the key question we're trying to ask is, can we identify driving forces for phase separations for archetypal IDPs? We'll focus on those with prion-like domains, and we'll show that they're actually sequence specific. So here's the FET family proteins, FOS EWSR1 TAF15. And what you find is that there's a concentration dependence to their phase separation in physiological salt of about, 150 millimolar potassium chloride. This is sequence specific in the sense that if you go to things like HNRNP-A1 or A3 or DL, you have to go to higher concentrations before you start to observe droplets. So what one can do is sort of look at the underlying sequence architecture to see if there's anything that jumps out. And one of the things that jumps out is that these IDPs with prion-like domains actually have a blocky architecture. So the sequence that's the putative prion-like domain has seldom has any charges to it at all. And the RNA recognition modules, or the RNA binding domains, which are also disordered, have a boatload of charge, which makes sense. In fact, there's a selection for arginine, right? So here are data for FUS. So basically what one is doing is quantifying using microscopy the relative amount of condensed protein, and what you can actually see is that there's a threshold concentration above which basically most of the protein now becomes condensed into a droplet, and that concentration under these solution conditions is around 2 micromolar. Now, again, if you've been paying attention to the literature, FUS, all the fuss about FUS has been about its low complexity domain, right? The prion-like domain. Well, guess what? It's actually quite a puny when it comes to driving phase separation on its own. You need ridiculously high concentrations of the prion-like domain. And in fact, for the RNA binding domain, basically you have to go to insanely high concentrations that are undetectably large. But when you put the two together, even in trans, you actually can drive phase separation at molar equivalents that are sort of 15 micromolar, right? So this starts to suggest that the driving forces are not in one or the other domain alone. You actually need the synergy between these two. So I think it's safe to say at this point that a lot that has been learned by studying the LCD alone is interesting, but perhaps not physiologically relevant. So the picture looks something like this. The FUS prion-like domain, it has a saturation concentration up in the 120 micromolar range, but then you need to go down, you can go down to really low concentrations when you think about the full-length protein. Now the obvious question is, what is this pointing to? There, quite a bit of detective work led to the idea that it was the tyrosines and the arginines, and so then you stop and say, this must be cation pi, right? It's the way all of us sort of like to think. But of course, you can think of any number of cation pi systems. You can think about lysine, tyrosine, arginine, phenylalanine, lysine. Is there more to this than just cation pi? So following a series of calculations, Tony's lab basically set out to sort of quantify the comparisons between different mutations. So here's full-length FUS. Here is a mutation where all the arginines are turned to lysines in FUS. Basically, you have to go to fairly high concentrations before you see any droplets. Here is a construct where all the tyrosines are turned to phenylalanine. Again, it becomes quite a puny. And then conversely, if you replace all the tyrosines with phenylalanines and all the arginines with lysines, at the concentrations that the measurements have been performed at, you don't actually see any phase separation. There is a salt dependence to this, which is interesting, which is that both full-length FUS and the mutational variants will, of course, undergo phase separation at lower salt more prominently than they would at higher salt. But you need to go to really low salt, like 75 millimolar, before you'll see any kind of turbidity with the fully substituted variant. So what this suggests is that there really is sort of a hierarchy of interactions among these stickers. So the stickers are likely to be tyrosines and arginines, but when you're choosing stickers, tyrosines and arginines turn out to be superior to either tyrosine, lysine, phenylalanine, arginine, and certainly way better than phenylalanine, lysine, so much so that we now have the ability to quantify how many phenylalanines it takes to sort of do an equivalent job to one tyrosine, or how many lysines it takes to do an equivalent job for one arginine. So this brings us to a theory part, which says that you can actually sort of adapt the theory of associative polymers and basically predict out the saturation concentration. You can plumb through the theory, it's quite sophisticated, but the upshot is actually a pretty simple relationship that says that the saturation concentration is inversely proportional to the valence, in this case, defined by the product of the numbers of tyrosines and arginines. This comes directly from the work of Semenov and Rubinstein that Jungmo Choi adapted for us. And it actually does remarkably well. So here are a series of proteins, measured saturation concentrations that span 3 orders of magnitude, and the correlation is actually pretty good, but one shouldn't pat oneself on the back because there are actually some prominent outliers from which you can learn some interesting things, like TAF15 and the HNRNPs. where the tyrosines have been substituted. And in fact, what you see with TAF 15, an explanation jumps out right away, because this actually sort of is slightly different from FUS in that in the RNA binding region, you not only have arginines, but you actually have a very well-mixed pattern of arginines and tyrosines. So in fact, you have to go beyond just counting up numbers of arginines and tyrosines. One has to take into account the modulation of the effective valence due to either patterning or, in some cases, imbalances between the arginine and tyrosine contents. So, in fact, that's the RRM there. So the other point that arises is, okay, so now we can solve the problem of where does specificity come from, but what role do the other residues play? And these would be spacers, right? And many of these sequences have boatloads of glycines in them. So we're just starting to sort of make sense of these spacers. But the way you would want to think about spacers is that they would have to have a negligible impact on the saturation concentration, but possibly an important impact on the material properties. And so we'll just take FUS here, again, focusing on the prion-like domain. What we reasoned was that the glycines, by virtue of being achiral, must mediate chain flexibility and therefore interchain overlap. So glycine to alanine substitutions might actually have a contribution to material properties. You could also imagine that serines and glutamines sort of enhance valence and sort of contribute some non-specific interactions. And in fact, what you find is that the saturation concentration for all of these variants sort of remains largely invariant when compared to changes that you can get by changing stickers. But what's fascinating is that the material properties do change, because here's FUS, FRAP data. You can see what the recovery times when you sort of do this just 1 hour, 0 hour after frapping. But if you let them sit and then frap, essentially the material has hardened. But when you replace, let's say, all the glutamines with glycines, or for that matter, you turn all the glycines to alanines, what you end up basically getting are constitutive pebbles, essentially, right, when you remove the glycines. But if you increase the glycine content, you basically make immortal liquids. You lose the gelation or the solidification component or hardening component. So what we're actually in the process of doing is now integrating this idea of spacers into the theory for associative polymers. And so where we are is that stickers do not have to be folded domains that interact with one another in a stereospecific manner. Specific amino acids in the sequence will actually qualify as stickers. Tyrosine and arginine are actually superior, and we think it's because from a very classical standpoint, arginine has a charge, but it also has dipoles and quadrupoles, so does tyrosine in terms of a quadrupole moment. So essentially, what I would like to sell to you today is the way to think about these protein sequences is that you really think of them as chains of multipoles that give you sort of hierarchies of spatial ranges as well as orientations for interactions. And it appears that spacers basically contribute to material properties by determining chain flexibility, degree of overlap, and the density within droplets, which leads me to the last point, and I think I can cover it in the time that I have, which is another feature encoded by IDPs is the amplitudes of conformational fluctuations. A lot gets written that's really anecdotal and is seldom quantitative. So the question becomes, can we do better than that? So if you go back and sort of as far back as 2015 and sort of read, you know, the literature on what is the underlying theory for driving phase separation, it's this mean field theory of Flory-Huggins, which basically says that there is this parameter chi that looks at the interplay of protein-protein, protein-solvent, solvent-solvent interactions, and every bit of the magic sauce is essentially blended into this chi parameter. So the free energy of mixing says that the entropy of mixing in terms of the volume fraction of polymer is always favorable, so entropy alone will never give you phase separation. Everything comes down to chi. And when chi is positive, that's when we have the opportunity for two phases. When chi is negative, you'll basically get one-phase soluble systems. So for homopolymeric sequences, there is actually a direct relationship between the properties of a single chain and the phase behavior, right? So it turns out you can actually say, well, let me look at the radius of gyration, let's say as a function of the control parameter, which will be temperature. These low temperatures will correspond to positive chi. These high temperatures here will correspond to negative chi. And in plumb in the middle will be chi equals zero. So the relationship of solution conditions to chain dimensions and phase behavior will be as follows. So chi being negative will essentially be T being below this theta point. Chi equal to zero will be right at the theta point, or chi positive is sort of in excess of the theta point. So basically, the point here is that for homopolymers, the width of the two-phase regime will actually increase with decreasing dimensions. And I'll show that to you in this picture here. So here, if I'm plotting a two-page picture, volume, fraction, and temperature, basically the idea is that when chains form globules, they also have a very wide two-phase regime because chi is positive. But as the temperature increases, the width of the two-phase regime will actually decrease. And that you can actually read out from the single chain because the single chain is expanded. Yeah. OK. So the IDPs that are associative polymers will actually defy this theory. And this is work we did with Cliff Brangwen, and Shani is in the audience here. So we'll focus on the RGG domain, which has a lot of stickers but also spacers, but it's not a globule, right? But it actually sticks to itself quite a bit, as seen by second virial coefficients that are actually quite large and negative. And if you look at the predicted phase diagrams from Flory-Huggins, you get these completely absurd looking phase diagrams, which look nothing like the measured ones, where the volume fraction in the dense phase now is actually quite low. The key point is that to account for this, you have to take into account two things. The chain dimensions actually never change as a function of salt. But you can actually fit the underlying phase behavior using a theory that's from Muthukumar that basically accounts for two things here. There's the Flory-Huggins term, but then there's a three-body interaction term, but also the account of conformational fluctuations. But I see Peter standing there, so I'll stop and simply say that there's actually a very good explanation for it, but I'm sure you will ask me about it. So we'll simply tell you what the main messages are. So some IDPs will actually decouple their changes to chain dimensions from changes to intermolecular interactions. These are actually perfect mimics of stickers connected by spacers. It can only be realized for heteropolymers. So in this sense, IDPs, which have been sort of thought to be completely spaghetti-like, are actually quite a bit more interesting. And the key point is that from the single chain conformational properties, you can actually derive direct insights into their phase behavior, making them designable. And in fact, what this will give you in some cases are ultra-dilute droplets, which I know Shani will talk about as well. So I'll stop there. I think I have time for questions.
Thank you, Rohit. A lot of questions. Tim?
Section that you were talking about, how does the length of the linker influence the excluded volume?
Oh, absolutely. So there are two points in that in response to that question. The first thing is that in a generic worm-like chain, the only thing that matters is length, right? But of course, when you start taking into account sequence-specific contributions, what you realize is that you can realize or arrive at a chain of a particular length in terms of overall dimensions by using sequences of different charge contents and things like that. So there is a thermodynamic length that we refer to, whereby you ask the following question: if I want to get an end-to-end distance of X, do I have to have a chain of a particular length or a sequence that is shorter that can achieve that based on the stiffness? So, but going back to your question of what will the length do, there will be a length past which the domains will essentially become independent of one another, right? Because you effectively have two types of cooperativity here. The linkers help bring these domains together, so you end up with sort of the Bill Jenks-like avidity. But what you want to do is to make sure that those cooperative interactions are not between the same pair of molecules. You end up with a network cooperativity, right? You will lose that when the linker gets longer than a certain threshold. And again, depends on the linker properties. Right? And then you enter a regime past a certain linker length when you essentially get gelation without phase separation. And it turns out most of the linkers in multi-domain proteins are in this optimal range, actually.
Question.
Okay. Raphael,
thanks. I
saw Raphael. So, I'm Ashutosh from IIT Bombay. So, I have two related questions. So, your sticker one tyrosine and arginine that you showed and say showed that probably quadrupole and dipole could be different than phenylalanine and lysine. Has anybody quantified that what is the difference, like how much difference they have in quadrupole moment or dipole moment that triggers and makes it superior sticker than the
So that's a good lysine. Question without a good answer, because there are old-fashioned microwave measurements where you can get at these quadrupole moments. All I can tell you is that there are good numbers for things like paracresol and toluene and things like that in water. How those are as mimics of what you should see in a protein sequence are sort of up in the air. And this is where Tanya Mittag and my lab have been sort of trying to get at this, because NMR will actually turn out to be a fairly potent tool at sort of dissecting out these various contributions, because you actually have various, you can get at the local spin environment and so on and so forth. As far as calculations are concerned, this is where life gets really dodgy, because the number changes based on the force field that you use, right? So I can give you a number for tyrosine that will be, you know, X, and I can give you based on a non-polarizable force field, you do a DFT calculation, you get a completely different number. You do a LMP2 calculation, you get a different number. So at this point, I'd say we've motivated the need to dig deep. We just don't know what tool we should dig deep with as far as the calculation is concerned.
The second question.
Time, we'll take one more question here at the front.
There might be two other interactions that you might want to look at.
Oh, there
at,
you
I
are.
Thought.
Sorry. I can hear you. Yeah, I couldn't see you.
There are two other interactions that you might want to take into account besides cation pi. One is the possibility of the arginine in a non-charged state hydrogen bonding either to the tyrosine hydroxyl or to the peptide bond. And the other is of the tyrosine hydroxyl doing a side chain, main chain hydrogen bond. So both hydrogen bonds, in one case two types and the other case one type, might actually confer more specificity or an equal amount of specificity.
Sure. So as far as the arginine uncharged state is concerned, that's a reasonably good point. Actually, Peter St. George Hislop has data suggesting that arginines actually get methylated. And in FUS in particular, the phase separation is really driven by the methylation states of arginine. That, however, doesn't give you an uncharged arginine. Basically, what you end up with are these symmetric dimethylated or asymmetric dimethylated or monomethylated arginines. You still have the charge on there, but you basically now have sort of an increased hydrophobic character. So that was perhaps the only way to get to an uncharged arginine. Citrullination is another one that we have no evidence for here. Hydrogen bonds, when in doubt, always invoke hydrogen bonds. That's certainly a reasonable way to think about it. I guess I would say to you, I am less concerned at this point about the strength of any one particular interaction. I think the really interesting question is, how do you get cooperative effects due to particular types of stickers? So one of the things we're actually trying to do is say, instead of doing the brain dead thing of turning all the arginines to lysines, is there a sort of mixture or combination that turns out to be optimal? Because there are plenty of sequences that do a pretty good job of phase separation with just lysines or phenylalanines. It's just there's an interesting stoichiometric substitution. I think once we figure what that number is,
Rohit,
then we'll
we
have an idea
to,
of what
we
to
need
go.
To move on. So perhaps you can continue that discussion in private afterwards.
Okay.
So we need to move to the next speaker.